Hello children, so we are back with chapter metals and nonmetals. So in the previous video we had already spoken about physical properties and few chemical properties of metals. So we'll go ahead with few more properties of metals. So here we'll go with reaction of metals with acids. So remember, all metals react with acids to form their salts and they evolve hydrogen gas. So what is common in all such reactions is the evolution of hydrogen gas. And apart from that, they form their corresponding salts. But does it hold true for all metals? Of course not. Only the metals which are more reactive than hydrogen. I said all the metals which are more reactive than hydrogen in the reactivity series. That means they should be placed above hydrogen in the reactivity series, only evolve hydrogen gas. So we have already learned reactivity series in chapter 1. Try to recollect that magnesium, aluminium, zinc and iron, all these are placed above hydrogen. I'll highlight here for you. Therefore, they are more reactive than hydrogen, so they are capable enough to displace hydrogen in the form of hydrogen gas. So it's indeed an example or an application of displacement reaction. Okay, so remember that it's an application of displacement reaction. As I said, all metals will not react with acids. Okay, so here to highlight it for you, copper, silver and gold do not react with dilute HCl. The reason you might have understood by now, again related with reactivity series. So all these three metals are placed below hydrogen in the reactivity series, so they are less reactive than hydrogen. So they are incapable of displacing hydrogen from HCl in the form of hydrogen gas. Another very important board question is, this hydrogen gas, okay, is not always evolved. So particularly when the metals undergo reaction with nitric acid, hydrogen gas doesn't evolve. So why there is no evolution of hydrogen gas? Because HNO3 acts as a strong oxidizing agent. I've highlighted here for you. So since it acts as a strong oxidizing agent, the hydrogen so produced gets converted to water. Okay, when it gets converted to water, HNO3 will itself get reduced to form oxides of nitrogen. Hence, HNO3 is such a strong oxidizing agent that it even reacts with copper to give its salt, that is copper nitrate, but there is no evolution of hydrogen gas. There is a production of water and a reduction of itself, that is HNO3, to oxides of nitrogen. So indeed, it's an example of redox reaction, okay, but it's not a displacement reaction. So this is very, very important question for your board exam. It usually is asked in the form of reasoning based question. Okay, so remember this answer for it. So let us go ahead. Okay, so here let me fix displacement reaction for you. So we have already learned this before in chapter 1. So I'm not going into depth of displacement reaction. We already know displacement reactions are all such reactions in which a more reactive metal displaces less reactive metal from its salt solution. So to highlight few examples, I have taken magnesium and zinc because they are more reactive than copper. So the salt of copper is copper sulfate. So magnesium being more reactive knocks out copper, form magnesium sulfate. Likewise, zinc will form zinc sulfate and copper is deposited elsewhere. Likewise, we have also learned the reaction of iron with copper sulfate. So how iron reacts with copper sulfate, let us see this also. So just see here, iron is also more reactive than copper sulfate. Therefore, iron will form iron sulfate and copper gets deposited on the iron nails. Okay, this activity will be doing it in the lab as well, and we have already learned in chapter 1. So again, it's a which type of reaction? Displacement reaction. So here are the two figures. The first one is for the reaction, I'll write down here for you, which we learned before, magnesium with copper sulfate. So as I said, copper sulfate is blue in color, but magnesium being more reactive than copper displaces it to form magnesium sulfate, and copper is out. Now here also, this reaction is for this figure. Okay, so we have taken copper sulfate solution, in that we are dipping iron nails. So soon a color change will be observed from blue to green, and this copper gets deposited as reddish brown coating on iron nails. So all such examples are of displacement reaction. So here we go with reactivity series. Okay, I'm not going into depth of it, I just wanted to show you, so I have just put in this slide for you. As I said, all the metals which are above hydrogen are more reactive, and the metals which are below hydrogen are less reactive. So this we have already learned, and we have also learned the trick to memorize the reactivity series. I just wanted to revise that with you so that you can remember it very well, because it is being used everywhere. So P stands for pop singer called me at zoo. I like him calling me smart girl. Okay, so this is a trick what I told you to memorize. I repeat again, pop singer called me at zoo. I like him calling me smart girl. So this is how you can memorize the reactivity series. P, pop, potassium. Singer, S stands for sodium. Called, C stands for calcium. Me, magnesium, M. At, aluminium. Zoo, that is zinc. I means iron. Like, L means lead. Him, that is hydrogen. I like him calling what? Copper. Again, me, mercury. Smart, S for silver. And gold, that is G, smart girl. Okay, so we'll go ahead with next part, and yeah, let me set this for you. Yeah, how do metals and non-metals, this is and non-metals, react with each other? Okay, so this is very, very important thing. Metals have an ability to lose the electrons. Okay, they have an ability to lose the electrons and become a positive ion. That means we call all such positive ions as cations. This you have learned in grade 9. Hence, they are said to be electropositive in nature. Okay, so all metals are electropositive in nature. One such example I have shown over here. Now let us take an example of sodium. Sodium atomic number is 11 and electronic configuration is 281. So it has one electron in its outermost shell. So it is very easy to lose that electron and gain a stable configuration of 28. Likewise, magnesium, the electronic configuration is 282. It has two electrons in the outermost shell. So it is very easy to lose those two electrons and form a stable configuration of 28. So remember, if you remember How to calculate the valency which you learned in grade 9. Let me quickly just tell you the trick. If the valence electrons are less than 4, okay, like 1, 2 and 3, it is easy to lose those electrons. That means there will be loss of electrons. Wherein, if valence electrons are more than 4, like 5, 6, 7, okay, 8 doesn't, because 8 is a noble gas. It doesn't react at all. So if it is 5, 6 and 7, it has an ability to gain electrons. And one which loses the electrons, after losing the electrons, they form cations. That is the positive species. And on gaining electrons, they form anions, okay, which are negative species. So this concept is very, very important to understand. Now, let us see what about nonmetals. So nonmetals possess electrons more than 4. So they have an ability to gain electrons and become a negative ions called as anions. Therefore, they are called as electronegative in nature. Let us understand with an example like chlorine. Chlorine belongs to group 17. And here you will have to memorize the periodic table, okay? In chapter 5, we are going to do that. So chlorine belongs to group 17. It has a configuration of 287. As I told you, if it has 7 electrons in the valence shell, it has an ability to gain the electron. So if it gains the electron, it forms a negative charge species called as anion and attains stability. Therefore, they are said to be electronegative in nature. So remember, all metals are electropositive and all nonmetals are electronegative. Now, what happens when they react with each other? So there is a formation of a salt. So remember, when metal react with a non-metal, okay, there is an exchange, okay, of electrons. So metals are said to be donors, because they have an ability to lose the electrons. As I already explained to you, they are electropositive in nature. Whereas nonmetals have an ability to gain the electrons because they are electronegative in nature. So let us understand with the help of an example of NaCl. Now here it is very clearly mentioned sodium. It has a configuration of 281. So by convention, we should only show valence electrons. So how many electrons are present in sodium as a valence electron? It's just one. So here we have shown one electron. Okay. Chlorine, it has how many electrons in the outermost shell? 7. So count down here. There are 7 electrons shown around chlorine. Now what did I explain you? Sodium has an ability to lose the electron because it's a metal, it is electropositive. So it is going to lose this one electron and give it to chlorine, because chlorine is in need of one electron to get inert gas configuration or to attain stability, which is known as noble gas configuration. So by doing so, sodium, when it loses one electron, it gains a configuration of 2,8. That's a stable configuration. You have learned in grade 9 that the maximum number of electrons which outermost shell can have is 8 in number, right? So if 8 electrons are there in the valence shell, the octet of the atom is said to be complete. It's stable. Likewise, when it gains one electron from sodium, this chlorine, it gains a configuration of 288. Again, it's a noble gas configuration. Therefore, sodium on losing one electron forms cation. And how many electrons it has lost, that will be the charge. So sodium gains a plus charge. Now chlorine, since it has gained the electron, okay, one electron from sodium, therefore it attains one minus charge. So the charge on the cation and the charge on anion is decided by the number of electrons lost by cation, and the negative charge on anion is decided by the number of electrons gained by it. So therefore they combine together to give you a salt, NaCl. So since one positive gets cancelled with another negative, therefore NaCl is a neutral salt because it is formed by strong acid and strong base, and we have learned in neutralization reaction, okay, in chapter 2. But here we are not talking about neutralization reaction, we are talking about bonding, and this type of bonding is known as ionic bonding. So why is it called as ionic bonding? Because there is a formation of ions. That is cation over here, this is cation for you, and anion. So since cation and anion form in this type of bonding by losing and gaining, therefore it is known as ionic bonding. So I repeat, ionic bonding is a type of bond in which a metal donates its valence electrons to a non-metal, which gains that those electrons to attain negative charge. And by losing and gaining, both cation and anion attain inert configuration. Therefore, they become more stable. So this is an example for you to learn. And here I have mentioned clearly what all I have discussed with you. So this is an explanation of what I taught you. Now likewise, I'll just quickly discuss this example also of magnesium chloride. Now likewise, magnesium is a metal and chlorine, the same example as I discussed in NaCl. So magnesium, again, it has two electrons in the outermost shell. So it loses those electrons to form Mg plus 2 and gain a configuration of 2,8. Likewise, chlorine has 7 electrons in the outermost shell. So it gains one electron to gain a configuration of 2,8,8. So likewise, I have shown here two electrons around magnesium because those are the valence electrons, and 7 electrons around two chlorine atoms. Now each chlorine atom is in need of one electron, right? So what this magnesium does, this magnesium donates one electron to one chlorine and another electron of its to another chlorine. Therefore, there is an ionic bonding between magnesium and two chlorine atoms. Since magnesium has donated two electrons, it gains plus two charge, and each chlorine has gained one electron. Therefore, each chlorine has only one single negative charge. So this is how the formation of MgCl2 happens, and this formula writing also you have learned by crisscross method. So this is again the description of formation of cation, and cation is your Mg+2, and here are your anions, two anions, that is Cl-. So in this there is one cation and two anions. Cation is Mg+2 and two anions are 2Cl-. Okay, so when they add together they form MgCl2. Again, this is a example of ionic bonding, so understand it very carefully, and this is how you're going to represent it, because again in board exam they can ask you to represent ionic bonding in MgCl2 or NaCl. So I stop over here, just go through everything and discuss your doubts.